Then he went on to say, "Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me. Even give every man according as his work shall be." And finally, he said, "Surely, I come quickly." 2,000 years have passed. 2,000 years have passed, and just like Peter said, these scoffers in the last day say, "Where's the promise of his coming?" Everything continues just as it has. Nothing's changed. But the promises of God are both sure and steadfast.
Amen.
The promise is sure. And he's coming. And it's going to be soon. Our responsibility is to be ready for that moment to come. You know, if salvation could be obtained by offering a sacrifice to God, some ritual service, being good, keeping the law, Jesus would not have died on Calvary's cross. But he died in our place to pay the debt for sin he could not pay. And being under conviction is painful. I know by experience it is a horrible experience. But that conviction, that guilt of sin, weight of sin, is what brings us to Christ for mercy. You know, and Paul said in Romans, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I pray tonight, if you're here and lost, that you'll call on the Lord even while Brother Clint's preaching. If you feel the convicting power of God, don't wait for an invitation from us. You can come and seek the Lord. You can call on him right where you're at. Brothers and sisters, let's pray for Brother Clint as he comes to speak to us tonight in God's word. Bless you, brother. Bless you.
Like I say, it's good to be back. I can't believe it's Friday night already. Thoroughly enjoyed being here this week, and I've got a great blessing out of this revival, and I hope you have too, here at Huntingdon Missionary Baptist Church. But we need to remind ourselves that the revival is not over yet. We've reached the end of the scheduled appointments that we had laid out. But you know, we still got lost among us, and now is not the time to let up. But we need to be praying now more than we have ever. I'd like to begin tonight with asking you a little favor. I'd like to ask everybody a question in here tonight on the beginning. I'd like to ask you all, how many people by raising your hand, how many people have the thought to go through their mind today that this could be my last day on earth? If you had that thought in your mind, raise your hand. There's a few. Few raised their hand, but most did not. That's because we don't think that way as human beings. We as men and women and boys and girls, naturally, we don't think about our own mortality. We don't think about death being a reality to us, but we think about death as being a reality to somebody else. With that in mind, I'd like to say something that I want you all to remember. I want you to remember it throughout this service, and I want you to remember it to the end of this service. Hypothetically, I will say in 24 hours, beginning right now, we're all going to die. Remember that, okay? In 24 hours, everybody in here will be dead. And with that in mind, I would like to look in the Word of God and see what it says about death. And see what it says about the life of a man and how futile it really is. Let us turn over to the book of James chapter 4. In verse 13. James 4 and 13 says, "Go to now, ye that say today or tomorrow, we will go into such a city and continue there a year, and buy and sell." to repent before you die. Because one day, I assure us all of this, we will all die. We will all leave the walls of this life. Death does not discriminate by race or age or color or nationality or religion. Death does not discriminate. But the Word of God says it is appointed unto man once to die. And after this, the judgment. What that Scripture is telling us is we have an appointment. We have an appointment with death. And that's an appointment that we cannot cancel. It's not an appointment that we can get out of. It's not an appointment that we can say, I don't want to do that. We have no choice. Death comes upon all. It comes upon the great and the mighty. And it comes upon the poor and the lowly. I believe it's in the book of Ecclesiastes. Solomon wrote, a wise man. And Solomon, he looked at life. He looked at the world and he looked at the way that man lived. And he looked at the way that man tried to please himself. He looked at the way that man lived his life. And he concluded. He said, vanity of vanities. All is vanity. In other words, he said, everything about this life, everything that is material in this world, everything about us right now, with the exception of one thing, in the end, it's all going to mean nothing. How much money we have, what church we went to, how big that or how small that church was, or how many friends we had, or what kind of house we lived in, what town we lived in, what kind of car we drove, what kind of job we have, in the end, is any of that going to matter? Death is a sobering reality. I've never been put in that situation, but I can imagine. I can imagine the soberness that I would have if the doctor were to come in tomorrow and say, Clint, you got 2 weeks to live. I believe that I would all of a sudden have a different outlook on life. That's what death does to us. You know why we can't see that? Do you know why that man cannot see that? Although that we know deep down inside death is a reality, and that we know deep down inside that it's coming to all of us, why can we not grasp? Why can we not grasp and come to the reality that yes, today could be my last day on this earth? The world is drunk. Not on alcohol. The world is drunk on sin. The world is drunk on lust. The world is drunk on pleasure. What does it mean to be drunk? To be intoxicated, it means to have too much of something to the point where it impairs your vision. It impairs your decision making. It impairs the way that you walk. It impairs the way that you do anything. And that's what's happened to the world. They're asleep, blinded by the devil, and they don't know what's waiting on them. I want you to know, you here tonight that are lost, what is waiting on you. I want you to know what lies ahead, because I will tell you this. I don't know the day or the hour that any of us are going to die. I don't know the appointed time that God has for you, and I don't know the appointed time that God has for me. And the Word of God, I believe it's in that same book of Ecclesiastes that says that death comes upon us like the evil net upon a fish, the snare upon a bird. Oh, when we least expect it, that's when death hits. There was a lady, you've all already been talking about it. In case you missed it, there was a lady. She was 57 years old and she was here at Huntingdon Missionary Baptist Church on Wednesday morning. And most of us in here that was here that morning, we probably talked to her and had a conversation with her and fellowship with her and had a good time with her and talked about old times and talked about the good times that we've had with her in the past. She was the last person I talked to when I left here Wednesday morning. They found her dead Thursday morning. I wonder if death is that much of a reality to us. I wonder if death is such a reality that Because we know this is our last chance. We know that this is our last opportunity. You know, I believe that we should live each day like it is our last. We should treat every opportunity today like it's our last, because it may very well be. And to those of you that are lost here this night, I want you to understand something. If God is convicting you right now, treat this opportunity like it is your last, because it very well could be. Very well could be the last time that you ever have to be saved. People think and are arrogant enough these days that death is not a reality to them. I know you've all been listening to the news. Here in the past little bit, Ed McMahon, Farrah Fawcett, and Michael Jackson, three huge celebrities, icons of different generations, they passed away. And we build people up so much these days because they're an athlete, or because they're a movie star, or because they're a great singer or a great actor or whatever it may be. We lift them up. This world builds them up to the point where it becomes almost to the point where people don't think that they can die. People act like that, you know, it's the world's greatest tragedy that one of these celebrities has died. But you know what I realize tonight? They're no different than any of us. They're no different than anybody else on the face of this earth. They had the same appointment that we do. And their stardom and their fame and their popularity and everything else about their life, it was not going to deliver them from that day. It was coming. It was coming since the day they were born. It was appointed of them to die. Why? Because it says in the Word of God that the wages of sin is death. That's the price we pay for sin. We die. We die and we leave this world. Their fame didn't deliver them. They may hold the greatest memorial services that you've ever seen. I saw this afternoon that they got the Staples Center in Los Angeles reserved, and they're going to have thousands of police officers there and spending all this money, and they're giving out thousands of free tickets to all these observers to come and view the body of Michael Jackson. But you know, that does nothing for him. If he was not ready, if he was not prepared to meet that day, I don't care how well they dress him up and they show that a picture of the coffin with solid gold. I don't care if it's 24 karat through and through, the purest gold that this world has to offer. All of that means nothing now. Understand, this world in the end, it means nothing. It means nothing. Think about it for a second. What if we really did know that we had 24 hours to live? And when we received that news, how many of us in here would be thinking about our checking account? Who would care? What does it matter? You're fixing to die, I'm fixing to die. Who cares? How many of us in here today would be thinking about our job? How many of us in here today would be thinking about some other worldly thing? Or how many of us would be stressing over all these little insignificant things in our life that trip us up every day? Would we worry about it? No. No. Why? Because why does it matter? Why does it matter in the end? And that's what we've got to look at tonight. Not just right here. Not just right now, but I want you to take a look, lost friend, at the big picture. The big picture of life. And understand where you're going right now. And understand that the end of all things for you right now is destruction and damnation. Life is a vapor. Here 1 second, gone the next. Can't get out of that. The book of Ecclesiastes chapter 8, And verse 8 says, there is no man that hath power over the Spirit to retain the Spirit, neither hath he power in the day of death. And there is no discharge in that war. He said, you don't have power to retain life. You don't have power in the day of death to stay alive. We hear people say that you know, boy, somebody, they just held on. They just held on and they willed themselves to live. They certainly did not. Nobody has ever willed themselves to live. Nobody has ever just held on to life on their own. I assure us all of this. If anybody has gone through a situation like that, it is completely and totally by the grace of God. Because He gave us this life and He can take it away. The Word of God says we don't have power to hold on to life. We don't have the ability to hold on to life. It's God's to take and it's God's to give. And He said, and there is no discharge in that war. Back in the Old Testament, before they would go into battle, they would come to the troops and they would say, if there's anybody here that just really doesn't want to go, if your heart is not in this battle and you don't want to go to war with us, they would say, go home now. And there were times that they would say, if you've got a new wife at home, or if you've got children at home and you want to go be with them, they would discharge them from the battle. They would be allowed to go home. But death is not that way. We can't just say, well, I don't want to die. We don't have a choice. We can't just say, well, I want to live longer. We don't have a choice. I want to live, but you know, that's not up to me. I can try to do everything I can to stay alive. I can surround myself with the best doctors in the world. I can go out and I can find the greatest technology in the world. I can search this world over from the fountain of youth. Things to make me younger. Things to make me more vital. Things that would make my life better. But if it's my time, brothers and sisters and lost people here tonight, if it's my time, it's my time.
Right.
I don't care if I've got the greatest doctors standing right by my side with the greatest medical technology right there at their fingertips. If God wants me to die, then I will die.
Right. Amen.
If God wants you to die, you will die. There's a lot of things about the Word of God that I don't understand. There's a lot of things about this world that I don't understand. And you know, that used to bother me. I try to figure them out. I try to say, why does this happen or why does that happen? But then I started digging in the Word of God. And I read what Solomon concluded in the book of Ecclesiastes. He came to the conclusion that there were things past finding out. There were things in the world that he just didn't understand and was not going to understand. He said, I've applied my heart to wisdom. I've applied it to know these things. I've applied it to search out these things. He said, but yet God has made them too great. God has made them too high for me, and I cannot understand them. I don't understand why young people die sometimes, but it's not up to me to understand.
Right.
It's not up to me to figure out why a child is taken out early in life and never gets the opportunity to live and do things that we have done. And you know, we ask ourselves that question. We go to the funeral of somebody that is young, even somebody like Miss Carolyn, and we say, why so young? But you know, when it comes down to it, all we can conclude is it was her time. It was just her time, and we don't have to understand everything else. There's no reason for some things.
Right.
You know, we think everything has to have a reason behind it. And I think we try to look for comfort in that, and we say, well, that's not me. That's not my circumstance, so I don't have to worry about it. Solomon said the race is not always won by the swift. He said, the battle is not always won by the strong. He said, but time and chance happens to all. In other words, he said, things don't always that's not the way that it goes. If things went the way that they always should, the person with the strongest army would always be in every battle. But we can look at the history of the world and know that that has not always happened. We say people have to live to be old. People have to live to experience things. People have to live to get that job they've always wanted. People have to live to graduate from college. People have to live to have a family. But we know from experience that things don't always happen that way. Time and chance happeneth to all. It's coming to all of us. But I can proudly say and stand before you here tonight and say, if I never accomplish all the goals that I have set for my life, if I never become in this world what I set out to be, and you know what, I think that may be it's a good thing. But if I never reach those goals, and if I never do those things that I have set in my mind to do, if I never accomplish any of those things, I can say my life has not been a failure.
Amen.
Because I have something. And you have something here tonight. If you've been saved, you have salvation.
Amen.
What is this life? I say this life is preparation time. God gives us a span. Just like He gave the people in the days of Noah a span of time. You say, what was that 120 years for? It was for Noah to build an ark. And I say, no. I say, if God wanted to, He could have spoke the ark into existence and flooded the world right then and right there. But He had Noah to build that ark, and it took Noah 120 years. What was God doing? What was God's plan? What was the purpose of that? What was the purpose of that 120 year time period? I say it was God's span of time for men to repent. Noah was a preacher of righteousness, the Word of God tells us. What did he preach? It's going to rain. It's going to flood. And God's going to destroy this earth, and you better be ready. Turn to Him and be saved. Turn to God and be spared from His wrath. And yeah, I believe He told everybody He came into contact with. They come to Him, Noah, what are you doing? Noah, why are you building a boat on dry land? Noah, you tell me it's going to rain, but it's never rained before. I don't believe you. And they just went on. But yet God gave them a span. You here tonight that are lost, I want you to understand God has given you a span of time to repent. But with each day that passes by, that span of time grows smaller and smaller and smaller. And there's something else that I want you to understand. You can't come to God unless He is drawing you. There's a lot of people in the world today that will say you can be saved anytime you want to be saved. All you got to do is just come to God. But you know, I find in my Bible that there is but one seeker. There's just one seeker, Brother Stapleton. We're not the seekers. Who is the seeker tonight? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, I come to seek and to save that which is lost. I did not first seek the Lord, but the Lord first saw me. And you cannot be saved tonight unless the Lord is seeking you, unless He is drawing you by the power of His Holy Spirit, unless that door of opportunity has been opened while that conviction has set in. That is the only time you have to be saved. And no one is guaranteed a certain number of times. We're too quick to say that God has to do this and God has to do that. Listen, God is bound by one thing and one thing only, and that's His Word. He is bound by His Word because He said, I cannot lie. So God is bound to do the things that are contained in His Word. But I'll tell you one thing, I have never found anywhere in the Word of God where it says God has to give a lost person so many and so many and so many chances. It's never contained in there. It's not written in there. Understand tonight, this could be your last chance. And you know, I can't make you see that. I know that. But God can. You know what God did to me I tell you what he did to me. He made death real. He made death a reality to me. I realized that I could die. I realized that I was not immortal. And I realized that just because I was 19 years old, I wasn't entitled to a free pass to live tomorrow. God showed me, you can die. You can die, and you're in a dangerous position to die, because if you were to die right now, you would go to hell. If you're lost and you die, there is but one thing, and that's hell. There is no other alternative. There is no other way out. There is no way of escape. Once you die where the tree falleth, there shall it lie. Yeah. It's there. The condition of your soul, when you take the last breath of this body, that's where it's going to stay. Either eternally saved or eternally condemned. Let us read a few verses of Scripture in the book of Luke. In chapter 16, verse 19. Very, very familiar Scripture tonight. It says, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes looking to torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that will come from thence. We have an account of two men, two very different men, but yet they had one thing in common. One was rich and one was poor. One was lost and one was saved. But they did have one thing in common. They both died. They both died. And they left the walls of this life. That rich man fared sumptuously. He didn't do without. He never knew what it was to want. And then you have Lazarus there, waiting for the rich man to give him a few crumbs. Covered from head to toe with those sores, and the dogs came and they licked him to try to ease the pain. We find out that there came a time where they were both put on level ground. There was no rich and there was no poor, there was no high and there was no low, there was no mighty, there was no weak, but when it came to the day of death, they were both equal. They were both appointed unto that day, and they both had to keep that appointment, and when God called, they both answered.
Yeah, that's right.
But then that's where the similarities disappear. That's where the similarities go away between these two men. And you know, I thought about how we are here tonight. I said it earlier this week, I can look in this congregation and I can't pick out the lost from the saved. Because in a sense, we all look the same. And you know, right now we can eat at the same restaurants. We can go to the same church. We can stay in the same hotel. We can go to the same cities. We can go to the same ballpark. We can do the same things. But when the day of death comes, that's where the similarities will stop between the lost and the saved, because there'll be a separation.
Amen.
It's not going to be like this forever, sinner friend. Not going to be like this forever.
will one day be brought down low. It's lifted up right now. It's proud. It's arrogant. But one day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. My advice to you tonight is, don't wait and be humbled by the torments of hell. Don't wait and be humbled by the wrath of God. Don't wait and be humbled on the other side of the grave, but humble yourself now. Call on the Lord now while there's still time. Call upon the Lord tonight while you're given the opportunity. For if you wait too late, there is no more opportunity. And this rich man found that out. As we would say, he found it out the hard way. He said, Lord, have mercy on me. You know, he cried out for mercy. He said, have mercy on me. And send Lazarus, just let him dip the tip of his finger in water and let him drip that drop of water on my tongue. He said, for I'm tormented in this flame. But he said, I can't do that. You know, it occurred to me that if that rich man would have cried out for mercy while he was still alive, he would have gotten it.
Amen.
It occurred to me that the rich man would have been as humble as he was right now in hell if he would have opened himself in that way and cried out unto God in that manner and asked for mercy then, he would have gladly gotten it. God would have gladly saved his soul. God would have gladly shed his mercy and his grace upon him. God would have gladly forgiven him his sin and given him eternal life, gladly and freely. But he waited too late. He waited till he was in hell to seek those things. And it was too late. And Abraham said, we can't do that. He said, there's a great gulf that divides us. And he said, anybody that would like to go from us to you cannot, and nobody can come from you to us. We are separated eternally. And that's what I want you to understand about hell. You hear that are lost, hell. It's an eternal separation from God. It's an eternal separation from God's people. It's an eternal separation from grace and from mercy and from all the good things that we can read about in the Word of God. You'll be forever separated from those things. Well, then his attitude changed. He said, well, I have no hope. I'm stuck here. And I'm not getting out. And he said, then he said, I pray thee, therefore, Father, that thou would send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Think about it for a second. I mean, if we really think about the Word of God, think about what this rich man asked for. I don't know about you, but if I'm in a tough spot, if I'm in the hospital and I'm in pain, I want my family with me. I want them there by my side because I feel comfortable around them. I want them with me because they can help me. They can bring me comfort. They can speak comforting words to me. I want them by my side. What would make a man? What would make a man say, please, please don't let my brothers come to this place. Please don't allow them to get here because it's too awful. Hell was so awful. It was so bad that he said, I don't want my brothers here. I don't want my brothers to be with me in this place. Under normal circumstances, he would have said, please let them come here that I might have some kind of comfort. I want you to understand something. You're not welcome in hell. People in hell don't want you there. This rich man, he didn't want his brothers there. He saw firsthand what hell was and how bad it was and how the separation from God felt and all the torments that awaited him there. And he prayed. He said, Lord, don't let my brothers come here. People in hell don't want you there. But if you die lost, that's where you're going. I don't know how to put it any simpler are plainer to you here tonight that are lost. Because Abraham said that he didn't make that Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went into them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. What did Abraham tell that rich man there? He said, rich man, they have all they need to keep from coming to this place. They've got the Word of God to warn them. And they've got the gospel of Christ there. They've got the words of Moses even that's being read in the synagogues on the Sabbath day. The Word of God is there to tell them and to teach them about hell. And the Word of God and the preachers are there to tell them about hell and to warn them about this awful place. He said, if they won't hear them, neither would they believe though one rose from the dead. I will close with this tonight, lost friend. Do you know what you're going to get? Are you looking for God to just knock you down on the floor and make you be saved? Are you looking for God to just make it to where He's just going to drag you to this altar? Are you looking for God to make you do anything? I'm going to tell you something. I'll tell you what you're going to get. You're going to get what this man preaches to you every Sunday. And you're going to get what I preach to you this week. And you're going to get what any other preacher that stands for the truth preaches out of this Word of God. You're going to get a warning. It's just like a sign on a road. If we see a sign that says bridge out, we don't push the gas down to the floor and go faster. We stop and we turn around. Why? Because that sign warned us of the danger ahead. Well, consider this tonight and consider every sermon that Brother Stapleton or any other preacher has ever preached. Consider it a warning of the danger that lies ahead. Think about it. Do you remember what we said in the very beginning of this service? In 24 hours. We'll all be dead. Sinner friend, if in 24 hours you're going to be dead, you better take advantage of this opportunity. Because I want you to know that although that is a hypothetical situation, I don't know. I don't know when you're going to die. I don't know when I'm going to die. But I want you to know it is a reality that you could have one day to live. Not even that. It's a reality that you could have 1 hour to live. We just don't know. We just don't know. Don't put it off to tomorrow. Don't put it off till Sunday. Don't put it off till next week or next month or next year because you may not have this opportunity again. It's a precious opportunity that you've been given tonight. God bless you, brother, as we get this song of invitation tonight. Has God dealt with your heart? Has God convicted you of your sin? Has He shown you the need that you have for Him? Please come and be saved before it's too late. Please come and repent on this side of the grave. Repent while you still have time, as we sing.